So I understand the soldier that you wrote about, this is not his real name, but tell us who this guy was.
Well, Abu al-Majd, which is his nickname, was one of this sort of comically large entourage of government fighters, intelligence officers, minders, who followed us around Palmyra, the desert town, which is famous for its beautiful ruins from antiquity. When we arrived there in the spring of 2014, no journalist had been there in some time, and I think we were some of the last international journalists to be there. So all these government people were assigned to just keep an eye on us, and not only to protect us, but probably also to control us. And he was one of them. And of course, we talked with him and with others, and got all their phone numbers, and he ended up keeping in touch with us for more than a year.
So he sends you texts, you see updates from him on social media. I mean, what kind of communication are you having back and forth over the year?
Well, often he was talking with my colleague Hwaida Saad, who is a brilliant journalist with a special knack of getting people to open up about their lives, and who speaks Arabic, which he didn't speak English. So most of the messages were back and forth with her, and I was also asking questions and, you know, sharing in the communications. And it was very informal. It actually is quite similar to how we communicate with literally hundreds of sources, both me and Hwaida and other members of our staff. So Hwaida would often just get text messages from him at random times, and other times we might contact him because we had a question about something specific that was going on.
So you mentioned in your report that he's a Syrian soldier. What did you get a sense about his sense of, was he an ardent pro-Assad fellow? Where did he fit on the political continuum?
He came across really as an everyman. Of course, we've had contacts like this with many people who are insurgents or activists or just ordinary civilians. And he's a guy who happened to be fighting for the government. He actually was a police officer who had been dragged into more military roles over the years. But he wasn't one of those loyalists who's always putting up pictures of Bashar al-Assad, or there are people who sort of gloat about dead insurgents or bombings that happened. He wasn't like that. He was just a guy who posted pictures of his nephew on Facebook. You know, when we asked him about his political views, he was a pretty apolitical guy. He just said, you know, I'm from a military family. I believe that you have to be with the state. You can't be with these armed opposition groups. You're either with the state or you're with terrorists. He was really critical of the way the army was being run, the way his cousin ended up in a firefight with 10 inexperienced guys without proper weapons or a means of escape. He had story after story about this. So, you know, he was someone who was loyal. I would describe him as a loyalist, but he was not idealizing the government or blind to its mistakes and faults.
Your story ends where he is sent back to Palmyra, the place where you first met him. Can you tell us what happened there?
Well, you know, we got a couple of pictures from him. At this point, it was pretty clear already that Palmyra was going to fall, or that it was really already falling. We had already heard from other fighters who were there that they were running away. So it was just almost bizarre that he was being sent there. He sent us two pictures saying these might be the last pictures. And then we didn't hear from him again. But what we found out later was that they were sent out there on a soft skin bus without proper weapons. They were dropped off at a base. And that night the base was attacked and they had to run away. He hid in the house of a local who he knew. And, you know, he actually had a decent reputation. Some of the people there were disliked. They were associated with mistreatment of the locals, but people said that he was more like a normal guy who just happened to be serving. And so people took him in. And after a while, he worried that he would be putting them in danger because Islamic State fighters were going around, you know, literally executing any soldiers or pro-government fighters or even government employees that they could find and punishing the people who had been hiding them in their houses. So he tried to walk away. And we confirmed this story with three or four people who witnessed different parts of it. he happened to be walking when the call to prayer came. So he had to go into the mosque because Islamic State requires all the men to pray in a mosque. And he was recognized. They asked him, "Are you with the police?" He said, "Yes, I'm not doing anything. I'm just praying." And they took him out in the street and they beheaded him.